Welcome to the second webinar for the Botsteba Institute for Wildlife Fertility Control. My name's Kathy Herbert, and I'm from the University of Sydney, Australia. And today I'm going to talk to you about life in the big smoke, peri-urban kangaroo management using fertility control. Now, sometimes when you think about kangaroos and you think about people in Australia, you sort of joke and you say, well, surely everyone must ride a kangaroo to school. Well, I'm sure you all know that's not the case, but recently we had a really interesting occurrence, and that was of not a kangaroo, but a wallaby actually hopping across the Sydney Harbour Bridge. Now, admittedly, it doesn't happen every day, but it just goes to show you how close kangaroos and wallabies are moving into our cities and some of the potential challenges that we have in managing them. Now, while a wallaby hopping across the bridge may be rather unusual, there are lots of other things that we encounter every day when it comes to kangaroos in Australia. And here's a short video to show you the many faces of kangaroos in Australia. That video gave you a nice insight into some of the issues we face with kangaroos in peri-urban areas. We can probably divide these down into two main concerns. One is the increase in human-kangaroo interactions, especially in peri-urban areas in regional centres. This predominantly comprises kangaroo vehicle collisions and kangaroo attacks on people. Secondly, habitat fragmentation and isolation more generally is occurring at a rapid rate. Infrastructure development is isolating kangaroo populations, which frequently results in an increase in kangaroo density, overgrazing, and poor kangaroo health. This is what I've termed the downward spiral to poor health in peri-urban kangaroo populations. What we often see is an increase in development, usually through the development of roads, but also suburbanization, which then results in an increase in isolation between different kangaroo populations. Things like roads limit their ability to move throughout the landscape. An increase in isolation in turn leads to an increase in population density, as growing kangaroo populations are limited in their capacity to move and disperse throughout the landscape. The long-term effects are basically a downward spiral towards poor health, where we see animals showing signs of lethargy, emaciation, and eventual starvation and death. This phenomenon has occurred in numerous peri-urban kangaroo populations. The primary species of concern is the eastern grey kangaroo. You can see on the map of Australia there in light shading the distribution of kangaroos along the eastern coast of Australia. You can also see the major city centres of Brisbane, Sydney, Melbourne and the Australian Capital Territory. Australia is one of the most urbanised countries in the world, and the distribution of eastern grey kangaroos coincides almost precisely with areas of high human population density. It's a potential recipe for disaster. Add into this the unabated coastal development with major road infrastructure projects, and there's huge potential for the isolation of populations along a narrow coastal strip. One of the sites I work in is in the Coffs Harbour region of New South Wales. This map here shows the kangaroo populations within this particular region. Each colour shaded area here is an individual kangaroo population. The black line here, which I'm denoting with the mouse, is that Pacific motorway there. So you can see the huge potential here if this motorway is limiting east-west movement of animals for animals to become isolated on this coastal strip. And I believe this is already happening. This is just a nice example here of roads being developed exactly where kangaroos are occurring. So this here is one of the sites that I'm working on in this particular region. It's a small isolative habitat on a headland. You can see that there are suburban dwellings to the north, and there's also the motorway, the Pacific motorway there, further to the west. What we're seeing in this population is a significant increase in kangaroo population size. The blue bars here denote the population of eastern grey kangaroos at this site, and the orange bars denote the population of a second species of macropod, the red-necked wallaby. And you can see here between June 2016 and February 2018, there's been a significant increase in the population of eastern grey kangaroos, possibly stabilising in February 2019. So what's the problem with this increase in population size? Well, what we're seeing at this particular site here is poor health of kangaroos. We're seeing widespread lethargy, particularly in subadult animals. And based on some of the blood parameters, which is shown on the right-hand side here, we're seeing evidence of non-regenerative anemia. We've got lower concentrations of red blood cells. So the two right-hand columns here are this particular site for adults and subadults. The far left two columns are a control site where animals are in good condition. They've got reduced hemoglobin concentrations and reduced packed cell volume or hematocrit. So to put this into some sort of perspective, if you're not familiar with blood parameters and what this means, if you took your pet cat to the vet and they had blood values that were looking like this, your veterinarian would be suggesting that your pet needed a blood transfusion. That is how significant these results are. Coinciding with this non-regenerative anemia, we're also seeing high ectoparasite prevalence. We're seeing infestations of these little mites here in regions like in the pouch. You're getting congregations of mites here with infection and inflammation of the teats. Overall, the animals are displaying poor resilience, and we're seeing that juvenile growth is stunted. This is work that's been undertaken by my PhD student, Mikkel Brandemarty. So how do we manage this conflict? Kangaroos are suffering in many peri-urban areas, and there's also a lot of people who are suffering because of the conflict. Well, when we look at managing kangaroos in rural areas, it's fairly straightforward. If we have a problem population of kangaroos in a rural area, we literally normally just shoot them. So this is either commercial harvesting or it could be damage mitigation. But when we're talking about kangaroos in peri-urban areas, what's the best way to go about this? Often there's a reluctance by land managers and wildlife managers to use lethal control because of socio-political factors that are influencing their decision-making process. Also, in many cases, it might be unsafe to use the high-velocity firearms which are required to humanely dispatch a kangaroo via culling. So perhaps we could look at maybe maintaining these adults in the environment, but stopping them reproducing so that we don't get these little guys coming through. There have been a number of studies looking at public perceptions of management of kangaroos in peri-urban areas. And in most of these studies, they've all found that the majority of peri-urban residents do not agree with culling as a management technique for kangaroos. So this has spurred a whole lot of research into fertility control as a potential alternative option. Fertility control for kangaroo populations was traditionally focused on fenced populations. Back in 2004, I wrote a review paper looking at the potential for long-acting contraceptives to manage peri-urban kangaroo populations. And in this review, I put in this lovely table here, and my focus was pretty much almost entirely on populations of kangaroos that were fenced. But what we know now, based on the work we've done studying the population dynamics of kangaroos in peri-urban areas, is that many of our peri-urban populations are behaving almost effectively like a fenced population. We're seeing really high levels of site fidelity, and we're seeing really limited movement, particularly of females. And so what this means is that we have the capacity to manage on an individual site-by-site basis using fertility control. So for example, this is a GPS plot showing where one individual female kangaroo spends most of her time. This here is a golf course, which is about 1 kilometer wide here. And you can see that she's only really occupying pretty much half of a golf course there. Historically, we've often focused on surgical sterilization and often vasectomy of males when it comes to using fertility control for kangaroo populations. Current approaches, though, tend to shy away from surgical sterilization and tend to look more at contraception. But let's briefly just go through the different options. So in the case of surgical sterilization, the main options that have been used for kangaroos involve either vasectomy of males or ovariectomy, so that's removal of the ovaries for females. When it comes to contraception, there are a number of different options available, and these can be broadly divided into hormonal contraceptive implants or immunocontraceptive vaccines. So these two categories of contraceptives have quite different mechanisms of action. If we look more at hormonal contraception, this can be further divided into two types of contraception: those contraceptives that are based on steroid hormones and those that are based on non-steroids or peptide hormones. Now, in the case of kangaroos, we often use a steroidal contraceptive that basically contains a synthetic form of progesterone or a progestin. In the case of non-steroidal or peptide hormones, there's another product that we use, which is called supralorin, which is basically a gonadotropin-releasing hormone agonist. Immunocontraceptives are different in that they're not hormonal products. They're basically like a vaccine, and they aim to vaccinate a female against some necessary component of reproduction. So the product that's used most commonly for kangaroos is gonocon, and this effectively vaccinates the female against gonadotropin-releasing hormone. So if we firstly take suprelin, or GnRH agonist implants, the active ingredient in these is desloralin, which is either formulated as 4.7 milligrams or 9.4 milligrams within the implant. It's a simple subcutaneous injection after kangaroos are captured. The implant itself is quite small, about 1.2 centimeters by 2.3 millimeters. So to put this into perspective, this is a little bit longer than the microchips which you use to identify your pets when you take them to the vet. Now, there's no anesthetic required for treatment, although capture of kangaroos usually does involve immobilization. So by default, they're anesthetized. So what are the outcomes for suprelin treatment? So the approximate time to birth, to the first birth post-treatment here after giving one 4.7 milligram implant is around 510 days. There does seem to be a dose response effect in that if you give them a higher dose, you get a longer lasting contraceptive effect. So with a 9.4 milligram implant, we get contraception for around about 600 days. But given that it costs twice as much money for a 9.4 milligram implant, you're not really seeing any cost benefit there for that slightly longer duration of action. So what about the progestin implants? The progestin product that's used on kangaroos is levonorgestrel. And depending on the particular study, kangaroos have either received 3 70 milligram implants or 5 55 milligram implants. The hand here holding these six little rods, these are actually an old version of a human product which used to be for sale, but they're approximately a similar size to the product used for kangaroos. Now, these progestin implants are normally administered following a local anesthetic to the location where they're about to be inserted. The insertion site is then closed with degradable sutures, and again, capture involves immobilization. You can see on the right-hand side here some colleagues from the University of Melbourne in a mobile field station here implanting contraceptive implants, progestin implants, into eastern grey kangaroos. So what are the results for progestin implants? So we see a really high level of efficacy with progestin implants. And if we have a look at this graph here, on the y-axis we have the number of females without pouch young, and on the x-axis we have the year here. So with the exception of some years, in general, more than 80% of female control animals had a young in their pouch. So remember, this is the number of females without pouch young. Whereas if we look at those that received the levonorgestrel implant here, we see that we have greater than 90% efficacy for the first 5 years. The efficacy then declines to about 60% after 7 years. And I'd just like to acknowledge my colleagues, Michelle Wilson and Graham Coulson, for letting me present their data here. Okay, what about the gonocon immunocontraceptive vaccine? So this is an intramuscular injection, usually into the thigh muscle. It's a 1 milliliter injection containing 1,000 micrograms of gonocon. At the moment, the standard practice is to capture the animal in order to inject the gonocon vaccine. And so there's no actual anesthetic required for the treatment, although, as I mentioned before, capture for kangaroos does usually involve immobilization. The results for the gonocon immunocontraceptive work, similar to the progestin work, show really high levels of efficacy for very many years. So in the case of gonocon, we have greater than 90% efficacy for 8 years after treatment of subadult females. So here on the right-hand side, we can see a table which shows the number of females in each treatment group that were observed with young in each year. So we have the gonocon-treated females here, where literally no females reproduced for the first 3 years. Then we had one female that started to breed after that. So we had, as I say, greater than 90% efficacy. Whereas in our placebo-treated females, so the control females there, we had relatively high reproductive rates in most years there. And again, I'd just like to acknowledge my colleagues from the ACT, Lynn Hines, Claire Wimpenny, and Mel Snape for letting me use this data. So I've presented with you a few options there, but there are a few key challenges as well. All the methods that we routinely use currently at the moment require animal capture. As you can see from this photo in the right, in some ways that's not that hard. We can get fairly close to these peri-urban kangaroos because the distinct advantage is they're used to people. So they're quite habituated to the presence of people, and we can get close enough to dart within really easy range. However, darting animals is expensive, it's time consuming, and there's the risks associated with the handling of animals and the anesthesia for immobilization. This video here just gives you an insight into what it's like to actually go into a population, one of these peri-urban populations, and dart a female kangaroo. You can see that the animals are not very alarmed by our presence as we approach them. Here we're about 10 metres from our target animal in the middle, to the right of the screen now, and you can see they're starting to get slightly wary now. And that's the shot fired there. So they hop off some distance. And if we look at it again in slow motion, you can see the dart ricochets off and that's easy to retrieve there. So that whole process from seeing the target animal to actually darting her with the dart, hitting her with the dart, took about 2.5 minutes. So it is pretty easy to capture them. But imagine how much easier it would be if we could literally do that process and just deliver the contraceptive vaccine or the contraceptive implant at that point in time without having to immobilize them, transport them to a processing site and handle them and recover them. So one of the goals that we're really moving towards is to develop a remote delivery technique. So at the moment, what we've been doing is we've been looking at efficacy at the individual animal level. So in most cases here, we've got animals that are already tagged in the field. In this case, either with ear tags here or with a combination of ear tags and with collars. And we're trying to see, okay, if we remotely deliver either gonocon or suprelin contraceptive implants, what is the effect in terms of efficacy and longevity in the target animals? This image on the right-hand side here shows a female that's been darted remotely with gonocon and the needles just hanging into, the darts just hanging into her there for a short period of time before it drops out and can be, then be collected for disposal. So in the case of suprelin, and in both cases for both gonocon and suprelin, we've been working with NewDart, and a company in the United States. So in the case of suprelin, because it's a solid implant, we need to have a slightly different delivery system than for a vaccine, which is in a more liquid form. These implants themselves are a little bit breakable. So what we do is we initially load this implant into a gelatin capsule here. Initially, we were filling the body of the dart here with water for injection to help propel the implant out. And once this implant is loaded into the gelatin sheath, we load it into the cannula there of the dart. And we use the NewDart Excalibur injector for delivery. In terms of the results to date, so here I'm just building on the figures that I showed you earlier. When we hand inject a 4.7 milligram implant, we get a contraceptive duration of around about 510 days. When we dart deliver that same 4.7 milligram implant, we get a contraceptive duration of around about 375 days. So we're losing some longevity there, and that's probably because when the implant's being injected intramuscularly, it's potentially breaking into a couple of different pieces, which is increasing the surface area, and then it's releasing much faster than what it would if it remained intact. My colleagues in the Australian Capital Territory have similarly been working on developing a remote delivery system for the gonocon vaccine in collaboration with NewDart. So far they have some results out to year one post remote delivery of gonocon. And what they've found is that if they hand inject gonocon, so if they capture female kangaroos and then hand inject, the following year only 13% of those females have young. If they dart deliver gonocon, the following year only 21% of those females have young. Whereas those females that had a hand injected placebo, they had a fertility rate of 90%. So on the right-hand side here, this graph here just shows for three different sites or total numbers overall, the first 2 years pre-treatment for the dart-delivered animals versus the fecundity rates in the year after they were treated. So you can see a significant reduction in fecundity. So what we're seeing here with the remote delivery work is at the individual animal level, we've got reasonably high levels of efficacy, possibly maybe a shorter duration, definitely in the case of suprelin. But there are still some challenges. As I said earlier, when we've been doing these trials to date, we've been focusing on individual kangaroos who are already marked. So we can literally just fire a dart at them with either the contraceptive implant, or in the case of suprelin, or the contraceptive vaccine, in the case of gonocon, and we know who we've treated. However, when we go to live operations at the full population scale, we're not going to have the luxury of pre-tagged animals. So we need to have a way of administering the contraceptive remotely to animals and marking them at the same way. So again, my colleagues in the ACT have been working on identifying the best paint markers and working with NewDart to figure out a dart delivery system which can simultaneously administer the contraceptive and also mark the animal at the same time without causing too great an impact on the animal. And that's work in progress at this point in time. So if we're looking at population scale fertility control, what are the current deployment approaches? Well, at the moment, we can look at using fertility control as a sole method of control only really in isolated small populations. This is basically because of the laborious nature of capture and hand injection, which limit the scale of operations at this point in time. At most of the other sites where we're talking larger numbers of kangaroos, fertility control is usually at the moment seen as an option to employ in concert with culling. This is necessary for larger populations where it's difficult and or prohibitively expensive to capture sufficient individuals. And also it can be necessary if we don't treat animals early enough. Often we don't intervene with a population before it gets too large. And because we know there's a lag time between when we administer fertility control and when we see a reduction in the population size, sometimes we're forced to have an initial removal of animals before we can use fertility control. So in that option number one there, there's a lot of interest from, and there's numerous current trials going on small populations of less than 200 animals that inhabit sites like golf courses. And in these sites, particularly if there's an economic or tourism incentive to keep kangaroos on the course, shorter duration of action of the contraceptive implant or contraceptive product could be advantageous because some of these populations are often surrounded by lots of roads and the long-term survival of the population is not necessarily guaranteed. So if you're wanting them to persist, perhaps a shorter acting contraceptive could be useful in that scenario. But if we're looking at some of the slightly larger sites, I'll give you an example here of where we use contraception in combination with culling. So this is information or data from my colleagues from the University of Melbourne, so Michelle Wilson and Graham Coulson. So at Serendip Sanctuary in Victoria, they used a combination of fertility control and culling. In 2013, they went into the population and treated 75 females with levonorgestrel implants and tagged these animals so they were individually identifiable from a distance. Subsequently, there was a cull of 300 animals at the site. After these 300 animals were culled, it was determined that 85% of the remaining females were treated. In 2017, a further 45 females were treated. And it was predicted that if they hadn't done the fertility control in concert with the culling, that another cull, it was predicted that another cull would have been necessary in 2015. So this shows you that particularly in some populations that are already way too large for fertility control to work quickly enough, that fertility control can be used in concert with culling so that you can get an immediate reduction from the culling, but then the fertility control stops the big bounce back of the population and reduces the need to cull into the future. In the Australian Capital Territory, again, fertility control is not seen at this point in time as a replacement for culling. At the moment, populations are usually initially reduced to a desired size before applying fertility control. And then fertility control is used to slow population recovery and then reducing it and possibly even eliminating the amount of lethal control that's required in the future. Advances in remote delivery may further expand the utility of contraceptives in this particular scenario. So in conclusion, there's still a really significant demand for non-lethal control of peri-urban kangaroo populations. And if anything, the demand is increasing as development along the coast continues unabated. So basically, we have an increase in the number of kangaroo populations which are requiring some form of management intervention. I've presented in this webinar three products that are currently available to some extent. So we had the progestin or steroidal implants, the non-steroidal gonadotropin-releasing hormone implants, or the gonicon immunocontraceptive vaccine. As you saw from the presentation earlier, These all have different mechanisms of action, different efficacy, different longevity, and different administration requirements. So if we try to sum that up here in the case of kangaroos, Zeprelin has a much shorter duration of action, with only a duration of about 1 to 2 years versus greater than 5 years for progestins and greater than 8 years for gonicon. Each of these contraceptive products only require a single treatment before there's a contraceptive effect. Currently, they all require animal capture, but both Zeprelin and gonicon have the capacity in the future or the potential for remote delivery to be a real option. Whereas progestin implants, because of the size of them and the number that need to be used to treat a kangaroo, that's not really an option. Both Zeprelin and the progestin implants are commercially available in Australia, whereas the gonicon vaccine currently is not. It's under a special permit system. And for each of them, if I had to say, you know, what is the biggest limitation? For Zeprelin, it's the short duration. For progestin implants, it's the need to capture the animals. And for gonicon at the moment, it's the difficulty that we have in accessing the product. If you would like more information on anything I've presented today, please don't hesitate to contact me. And finally, I'd like to thank all of these people. The Botstiba Foundation for hosting this webinar, the Humane Society of the United States, and all of the organisations who have worked to help with this research on kangaroo fertility control. Thank you for your attention, and I'm more than happy to take questions.
Kathy, are you there?
I am. Can you hear me?
Yes, absolutely. I'll start with the first question. So I wondered, how do wildlife managers determine which fertility control agent to use in a given situation?
Yeah, that's a great question, Monique. And it really stems down to two things: what is available and also what the goals are for the population in question. So some of these small populations, particularly if there's an ecotourism operation associated with them, it can be good to have a shorter duration contraceptive so that from year to year you can decide to what extent you want to renew fertility control within the population, particularly if it's a population that might be subject to significant road mortality. You might want a bit more control. Whereas other populations that are sort of increasing indefinitely, ideally you really want a longer lasting fertility control agent. And the good thing about all of the options that myself and my collaborators have been investigating is that they're all at this point in time a single shot. So you just need one injection to achieve infertility in a female for the amount of time that I've indicated in the seminar. So we'll just see if other questions come in from the audience. One of the other things that we always take into account when choosing management options for kangaroos is that we look at the degree of connectivity of the population to surrounding populations, because ideally fertility control works best in populations that are relatively isolated or don't have a lot of movement of animals into and out of the population, and that helps us know that we can manage sites on an individual basis with fertility control or with any other form of management for that matter. So we'll just see if any questions come in now. So we've had a question here. So in relation to gonicon, given the usage of the dart delivery system, in the event of a misfire or other discharge resulting in contact with a human, are there any long-term effects that have been observed or projected? So this is a great question relating to human safety. So one of the potential issues with a number of the different products that we're using is that they affect the mammalian reproductive system similarly. So obviously there are potential consequences for people. So with gonocon, I personally haven't utilized this, but I understand those who do have quite strict guidelines as to who can handle the drug. Being a liquid, it is, I guess, more prone to potential accidental injection. But if a dart was to misfire and sort of spray onto the kangaroo's fur, for example, that wouldn't create an issue as the vaccine is not active by the oral route. In terms of having sort of darts within the environment, at the moment I understand the protocol is for the way the darts are designed is that they initially hang in to the kangaroo's skin for a short period of time, so we can watch the kangaroo, watch the dart drop out and collect that dart from in the field so that it doesn't pose a hazard to other people in the environment. The darts also are sort of, often we add sort of a adhesive label, if you like, to them that's quite reflective and easy to find them in the field. So we've had another question come in. What are the potential implications for the genetic health of kangaroo populations managed in this way? And are there particular individuals which will begin breeding sooner rather than others, effectively limiting genetic diversity? So that's a great question there. So what we've done, we haven't done modelling with kangaroo populations, but with koala populations, the genetic modelling suggests that having a reversible form of contraception where you can basically potentially let individuals breed at least once in their lifetime results in the least loss of genetic diversity compared with culling or surgical sterilisation. In terms of the question of non-response to contraception, there's definitely some individuals who fail to respond to the contraceptives in the same way that other individuals do in the population. And this is probably has some sort of genetic basis. So there is a risk over time that you could select for individuals who are resistant to the contraceptives effects, particularly perhaps with an immunocontraceptive, but we do also see non-response to the hormonal-based contraceptives as well. So the key thing there is firstly working out whether the failure of an individual to be contracepted is because of, say, a misfire of a dart or an injection, an incomplete injection, or whether it is actually a genetic resistance to the actual contraceptive itself. So that's definitely something that we're keeping an eye on. And trying to manage over time to see whether this is going to be a problem in the long run. So there's another question there saying, are there other species of kangaroos that pose population density problems? So the eastern grey kangaroo, being on the east coast of Australia, is the main species of issue, but around any of the peri-urban centres, so around and outside of Adelaide, for example, there are issues with western grey kangaroos, and the same thing outside of Perth, there are issues with overabundant western grey kangaroos, and we can at times get locally overabundant wallaby populations, particularly, say, for example, on some of the offshore islands where perhaps there's not sufficient predators to keep populations in check. So the same sort of approaches that we're using with eastern grey kangaroos are likely to be equally appropriate to some of those other species. And particularly when we're talking about some of the smaller wallaby species, perhaps a shorter acting contraceptive may be more appropriate depending on their lifespan and depending on their conservation status. Occasionally we get local overabundance of species which are perhaps not secure throughout their entire range, in which case some of the genetic concerns that were raised earlier could be a potential issue, so we may actually want to have a reversible form of contraception. So we've got another question here. So have you or your colleagues studied the behavioural response of females treated with fertility control and wondered if they, one, stop mating, equally males are not interested in them, and two, if they keep mating but not conceiving, are there any health effects? So this is a really great question here, and it's one that I'm really interested in. So the mechanism of action of both gonicon and suprelin contraceptive implants is to stop the female cycling. So effectively they're in anestrus. And for a kangaroo, it's actually natural for them to be in anestrus pretty much for 364 days of the year. They're in what we call lactational anestrus, where the suckling stimulus of the young in the pouch actually inhibits them from continually cycling there. Levonorgestrel has a couple of different modes of action. It can stop them cycling, so it can inhibit things at the level of the pituitary, where it stops the release of hormones which control cycling in females. That's not necessarily always the case, though, and it has some secondary mechanisms of action whereby it inhibits, it makes changes to the endometrium in the uterus, which can make it difficult for a conceptus to implant into the uterine wall, and it can also make the uterus itself impenetrable to spermatozoa. And so if that's the case, the female may still cycle and have repeated estrous cycles over time. And what we need to look at is if that happens with levonorgestrel, the extent to which this could result in increased male fighting or harassment of females. But as far as I'm aware, there are not any reports of that being a problem. So, but my personal belief is that it's better to stop females mating because if they're continually cycling, there is a risk of continued harassment by males and an increase in male-to-male aggression within the population. We have done some other work as well looking at the effects of suprelin on sort of day-to-day time behaviour, sort of budget analysis, and we found no particular effects on, say, the amount of time they spend eating or sleeping or moving or interacting with conspecifics. However, that research was done within a captive environment, and so it would be good to repeat some of that work within the field, and in particular to make sure that contraception doesn't alter their movement patterns, because if, say, they move more in an urban area, that could be problematic in terms of motor vehicle collisions, for example. So that's definitely something that we'll use GPS data to look at and track over time. So while we're waiting to see if any additional questions have come through, I just thought I'd add that probably the aim within a population would be that we would go into a population and with a contraceptive dart, for example, aim to dart 80% of the females within the population, and we do this within a finite sort of short time period. The dart itself would simultaneously mark the animal at the same time as we inject the contraceptive. So there'd be sort of a splotch of dye on the rump of the animal so that we could then estimate what proportion of the females we darted. Then depending on which contraceptive it was and how long the contraceptive lasts, we would then go back before the contraceptives are due to expire and then target, say, another 80% of the females within the population. That wouldn't necessarily be the same 80%, so there'd always be a proportion of animals in the population which would have the opportunity to breed, and potentially limiting some of the genetic consequences from not necessarily having the same females inhibited from breeding all of the time.
Okay, that might be it for our session. First of all, I'd like to thank Kathy for providing this excellent webinar for us, and thank you for everyone that attended. Please visit the Bostever Institute's website at www.wildlifefertilitycontrol.org for more of our events and information. Kathy, thank you so much.
Yeah, well, thank you. And thank you, everyone, for listening. If you think of any other questions later, please don't hesitate to send me an email. I'm more than happy to answer any questions.
That's wonderful. With that, our webinar ends. Thanks, everyone.